It's time for Florida State football. This is the Jimbo Fisher Show. The Jimbo Fisher Show is brought to you by the Florida Lottery, over $30 billion and counting to education. Just imagine. The energy-saving conservation programs of TECO People's Gas. Coca-Cola, try a game changer of your own. Taste the feeling. SunTrust, the official bank of Florida State Athletics. Ram, come in and get a great deal on the best trucks during Ram Truck Month. And by Nick's Toggery, provider of Coach Fisher's wardrobe.
Hello and happy holidays, and welcome to the Jimbo Fisher Bowl Preview Special. Jimbo's been out on the road recruiting. He's getting set for a big matchup in the Orange Bowl against Michigan. We're pleased to welcome Corey Simon, former Florida State All-American, to the show. And Corey, first of all, before we talk about the Wolverines and what's a terrific matchup in South Florida, all things considered, 9-3, considering where the season was at 3-2 at one point, you'll take it.
Yeah, you definitely have to take it. I mean, you look at this team and you see how they've grown over the course of this season. You had a lot of young parts, and I don't think the fans really understood plugging in a guy like DeAndre Francois, some of the growing pains that you're going to have there. You have to look back and say 9-3 is pretty darn great, and we look for big things to come going forward.
Well, and when you look at the year, I mean, all things considered, you go 9-3, but you beat Miami again, you beat Florida again. Dalvin Cook sets the all-time rushing record. And, oh, by the way, just for a little, cherry topping on top of the sundae, you're going to get Michigan in a bowl game, which this – I mean, you talk about two traditional powers. This could be fun.
Yeah, I think it really, really will be a great matchup. Two teams that are just traditional powerhouses. You got two dynamic coaches in Harbaugh and Jimbo Fisher. You couldn't ask for more in a bowl game that doesn't have national championship implications.
There's no question it will be one of the most watched bowl games outside of the college football playoff. We will talk about the matchup with Michigan. We'll also look back on the season that was 2016 for the Seminoles. So stay with us. We'll cue up the highlights right on the other side of this TV timeout. Welcome back. Let's start taking a look at some of these highlights. We opened against Ole Miss, Corey, and there was a lot of anticipation, ACC, SEC, Monday night stage. Big atmosphere for this one.
Yeah, it was an exciting time. I mean, over in Orlando, just a great way to kick off the season.
Except for the first half, where Ole Miss got out to a 28-6 lead, but a very big play just before half as FSU did start the comeback.
Yeah, and it really, if you look at this play, you see DeAndre Francois take a huge shot, which kind of foreshadowed the entire season, and deliver the ball down the field for a touchdown.
So the Noles get some much-needed points on the board, and then the defense, really the intensity across the board, gets ratcheted up. 4.5 sacks for DeMarcus Walker in this game, all in the second half. This fumble would lead to a touchdown that would put FSU ahead for the first time.
Yeah, and you look at DeMarcus Walker, I mean, he just didn't slow down after this game.
Florida State goes 7-for-7 in the red zone. They've been the best in the country since 2010 statistically, which mirrors when Jimbo became head coach. But again, just too much of DeMarcus Walker in this game.
Yeah, it was too much of DeMarcus Walker and that defensive line. I mean, they had guys healthy. Derek Nnadi was healthy at that time and played tremendously well.
Here you hook up with Izzo. Jameis Winston was on hand. Jimbo and the troops rally 45-34, the largest comeback victory in FSU history. They were down 22 before winning. So now you get the home opener. Everybody's excited. We're back at Doak. This should be a sure win against Charleston Southern.
Yeah, Charleston Southern was just an overmatched team. The talent of Florida State just really stuck out from the word go in this game.
Couple of touchdown catches for Travis Rudolph. Dalvin Cook didn't get 100 yards, but on 11 touches, he had 83 yards, couple of scores. Started to look like Dalvin of 2015. The big news from this game was this play right here where Derwin James, as it turns out, was lost for the year.
Yeah, just a really huge hit. And you look at how this defense played in the second half of the season, and you just think of what could have been with Derwin James out on the field.
This was the first time we got a look at Auden Tate, who began to emerge as the season went on. He gets his first career touchdown there. Ricky Aguayo, another newcomer, began his FSU career perfect, 7-for-7 on field goals. That'll work.
Yeah, definitely.
Florida State wins the game 52-8, but as we pointed out, loses Derwin James. So without your defensive leader, you go on the road for a big ACC showdown at Louisville, and obviously the Cardinals were ready.
Yeah, the Cardinals were ready. The Seminoles were not ready, and it showed from the start of this game. Lamar Jackson, our Heisman Trophy winner, just had a huge game against Florida State. And at that time, I think you could put away all of the national championship talk, and this team could go back to just focusing on winning ball games.
Well, that Tate touchdown catch, it was actually only 14-10. It looked like FSU might have found its sea legs. But here, Lamar's trying to throw to his tight end, overthrows him. There happens to be a receiver there, and it was that kind of day for FSU.
Yeah, it was. We just couldn't win. We didn't play well. We couldn't get pressure on the quarterback. We couldn't contain him. It's just one of those tapes that you don't even watch when you get back to the field. You just kind of throw it away and say, let's get better.
63-24 touchdowns rushing for Lamar Jackson and 146 yards. That launched his Heisman campaign. So the next week, everybody's thinking 63 points, first play from scrimmage. USF does it again and burns that secondary, and we think, here we go again.
Yeah, Quinn Flowers definitely took his shots in that game, and he managed to connect on a few early. But then again, Dalvin Cook, he does what he does, second play of the game, or first play on offense of the game, and takes one the distance.
Well, and Dalvin had a huge game 2 years in a row against USF. This day, he would go for 267 yards, second most in FSU history, a couple of touchdowns. And Florida State, when they got cruising, the middle two quarters of this game, FSU was red hot offense and defense.
Yeah, they really were. I mean, you know, I think we just love playing those Florida schools. And Dalvin in particular just really has a field day when it's time to get on the field with those guys.
Florida State gave up a couple of scores in the first quarter, and late when the game was wrapped up, the defense wasn't steady. But as I mentioned, in between, very, very good. 124 yards for Jarquez Patrick, part of a 478-yard rushing day for the Noles offense.
Yeah, that was some explosion there. The offensive line, tight ends did a terrific job of blocking in this game. You know, when you get everybody able to run the ball the way we did in that game, you just look at the offensive line and say thank you.
A 20-point win over a team that finished 10-2 this year in USF. So back home, North Carolina, and this maybe is the one that might sting the most. Carolina gets a big lead out to a 21-zip lead. Would have been worse early in the second half, but a big defensive stand there forces a turnover in Florida State on the comeback trail again.
Yeah, you know, this Florida State team just didn't play well all that often in the first quarter, and I think that's where we really lost the game. We just couldn't put enough points in the first quarter to go out there and really make our case to win this game. But again, in the second half, we go out there, we play pretty decently, gave up some big plays on the defensive end, and it really cost us the game.
DeAndre Francois, a redshirt freshman, though, leads a comeback drive here. And with 23 seconds left, FSU has the lead. Looks like you're going to get a win, but a career kick for Carolina's Nick Weiler, 54 yards at the horn, 37-35. Larry Fedora's team really stings Jimbo's Noles. And FSU at this point, 3-2 on the season, and this is a season that began with college football playoff aspirations.
Yeah, it did, and it really hurt us, you know, but you lost to some very good quarterbacks. I mean, Mitch Trubisky is a talented arm, went out there and played well. I think he only missed about three passes the entire day, so he really picked us apart. And then Lamar Jackson, I mean, you just can't say enough about the young man.
Well, as it turned out, you mentioned the quarterbacks. Florida State played probably the best set in the country this year with who that defense had to face. Talk about big plays from the first half of the season, and you and I had differing opinions here a little bit. I really thought when FSU had fallen behind 7-0 on the road against the USF team, they needed some response, and Dalvin showed right away not only was FSU going to respond, but Dalvin was back to being Dalvin here. Remember, there was talk, was he hurt? He just didn't seem himself the first three games. Well, he explodes out of a cannon here, the first offensive play, and Florida State would roll up some big numbers there in this game.
Yeah, but then I look back at my play, and we go back to it. It's Francois to Rudolph. Right before the half, when Florida State is down big, and he just takes a huge shot. And when you look at this in the microcosm, you just say, you know what, can this guy lead this team? Well, after that shot, I think we all realized that he was who he is, which is one tough quarterback that can lead this Florida State team.
Threw for over 400 yards that Orlando Labor Day night against Ole Miss. All right, that's the first half of the season. Things get better in the second half, and we will get to those highlights when we continue. Stay with us.
Strength, skill, character. The long-standing values that guide the Florida State student body. As representatives of this university, FSU student athletes have a responsibility to maintain these standards. Earlier this year, Florida State wide receiver Travis Rudolph was acknowledged for not just upholding these values, but exemplifying them.
Travis is the type of teammate, you know, if you need something, if you need help, he's gonna go out his way and do it for you.
Since his freshman season in 2014, Rudolph has made quite a name for himself on the field. However, this August, we saw his true character as he gained massive media attention by being himself and carrying out just another act of kindness.
I just saw him sitting there by himself, and during the time I was hungry, so I grabbed a couple slices of pizza, and I asked him, can I sit down with him? And he said, sure, why not?
Travis is referring to Bo Paskey, an autistic middle schooler who often found himself sitting alone at lunch.
When I sat down, he introduced himself to me. He said his name was Bo. He asked me, what's my name? And I told him, I'm Travis. And he actually asked me if I played in the NFL. And I told him, no, not yet. And I told him that, you know, you're an awesome person. And you can always be my friend. And I actually heard that, you know, after all that had blew up, like, a lot of people at his lunch were asking to sit with him. And he felt pretty good about that. So that put a big smile on my face.
In the time since this friendship began, Florida State football has taken Bo under their wing, bringing him and Leah on the sidelines at games and even giving Bo a customized jersey.
Yeah, Bo definitely is a celebrity now. It just shows you, man, the type of program we run here. You know, take people under their wings and, you know, like family.
This story is a great representation of the example that student athletes can set and how a small act can change someone's life in a big way.
I feel like, you know, everybody in the world, you know, has good hearts at the end of the day. And then just me doing something simple like that, that's just in me. You know, I didn't think it was gonna blow up this big.
Though his friends and teammates admire Travis for his actions, they were not surprised, as that is just the person that he is.
It just showed me, you know, the type of person that I stay with and the type of person that I be around every day. And, you know, I'm just proud of him, you know, the way he just go by himself, and, you know, the way he just handled himself, period, you know, I'm proud of him.
Many have taken note of Travis's hero-defining actions with Bo, including the producers of the Musial Awards, who chose him as a recipient of this year's Extraordinary Sportsmanship Award.
Honored, you know, that's the first thing that comes to my mind, honored to just be a part of that family, you know. And like I say, I still see myself as Travis Rudolph, but, you know, other people see me as a hero, so that's just a blessing.
Travis was unable to attend the ceremony due to an away game, but Bo and Leah took his place in St. Louis to accept the award. Though he wasn't able to give an acceptance speech, he does have a lesson to teach.
Anybody else that's watching, if you can be an honor to somebody, just take that step of making a big step of being a great person.
As football season nears a close, we look back at the big moments. Travis Rudolph displayed his strength and skill through catches and touchdowns on the field. But it was his character in the community that we remember as he showed us all what it means to truly be a Seminole.
FSU 3-2 through five games. Probably a good thing that rival Miami was next up, because the Noles needed to find some motivation, and playing the Canes will do it. FSU was ready to go from the get-go. Big hit by Jacob Pugh with a really kind of stunned Kaya there a little bit too.
Yeah, he did. And we got a chance to play against a quarterback that kind of stuck in the pocket for us, gave us some opportunities to make some plays, and we did that.
DeAndre Francois had a rough night as well. He took a beating. And Miami, despite Kaya looking a little bit dazed early on, would grab the lead. Great throw to Stacey Coley, makes it 10-zip. They could add to their lead in the third quarter driving, but inexplicably there, he really throws it when he's completely covered.
Yeah, and Terrence McFadden right there, he actually ran the route at that point, and he looked like he was the receiver that was intended to get the ball.
Great call by Jimbo on the throwback to Dalvin Cook. All he had to do was make sure he catches it because there was not a defender within 20 yards of him there.
No, that's just another facet of Dalvin's game that made him the elite running back that he is.
FSU comes from behind. They were up 20-13, but with a buck and a half or so left, here's Stacey Coley again. 2019, we're going to be tied. DeMarcus Walker with the block PAT. Talk about a huge block.
Yeah, Mr. Big Time, number 44, gets that big paw up there and just snatched the heart out of Miami.
The block at the rock, and Dalvin Cook, the side captain, and Ole celebrates 7 in a row over Miami. Back home for Wake Forest, ACC Sportsmanship Day, so the handshakes beforehand. And Wake Forest, not a great offensive team, but a good effort for the defense for FSU.
Yeah, it was. And Wake Forest plays tremendous defense. And so for us to get this win wasn't pretty, but we went out there. We played well on defense. Our offense did enough for us to get the win, and we walk out of there successful.
5 sacks. You saw the Marquez White pick. DeAndre gets a touchdown run there. And this caps a 96-yard drive to Auden Tate. As the Noles would win it 17-6, Tate will appear more frequently in these highlights as the year goes on. Nice to have a big target like that.
Yeah, that play looks a lot like Kelvin Benjamin going up for that snag to win the national championship.
No question about that. So the Noles back on track. They've won a couple in a row, get a bye week, and then get that much-anticipated date with the Clemson Tigers, a night game, wonderful atmosphere at Doak Campbell, and a terrific ball game too.
Yeah, it was, and the Doak was rocking. I mean, it was electrifying that night. Guys went out there, played their hearts out. You got to be proud of your Seminoles.
Again, FSU with a slow start, though. They fell behind 14-zip, start to come back, and Noonie Murray starts to emerge. Big catch, then a TD catch. He had 6 grabs for 96 yards. Remember, Bobo Wilson out for the year at this point. That's why we're seeing Noonie. Second half, it's a Dalvin Cook show again.
Yeah, and I know Dabo can't wait for Dalvin to leave Florida State University. He has really cooked Clemson these last 3 years.
First long one was 43 yards. This one, 70 yards. Noles go up 28-20. Dalvin with 4 rushing touchdowns. But Clemson has the lead late. Florida State has time to get in field goal position to tie it or maybe go for the game winner. But a couple of penalties push him back. And then on fourth down, DeAndre can't even get the pass off. And Clemson and Dabo prevail 37-34. Tough one for FSU.
Very tough game. Very tough game. Some questionable calls, but, you know,
Clemson, obviously, yeah, we have no choice into the college football playoffs. So FSU on the road. Place that's been very tough for them to win. Can't see it here, but a pick play gets the first touchdown of the day for NC State. And again, the Noles play from behind.
Yeah, it was that type of season earlier on. It was just tough for us to go out there and get started. Maybe we needed to play a quarter and then come out and play the game.
It sort of felt like that. We were behind 10-zip, tied it at 10, fell behind. Here Dalvin scores. Still, it took a fourth quarter drive and some terrific catches for FSU to get the win. That might be the catch of Kermit's career right there.
No question about that.
Noonie Murray gets in the action. He had 9 catches for 153 yards against NC State in this game. It was a 5-play, 83-yard drive. And where's your what turned out to be your game winner? Well, here it is. DeAndre gets hit again, and there's Rudolph.
Yeah, he was just Johnny on the spot earlier on in the season for us. We really needed that catch, and came up as a big one.
NC State with one last chance. Now, they couldn't settle for a field goal, so they're obviously going for it in fourth in field goal territory. And a defensive stand, FSU wins it 24-20. And so Florida State got back on track after that Clemson setback. And all of a sudden, boy, the season goes quick. Senior night at Doak Campbell on a Friday night Veterans Day against BC.
Yeah, and we really love our seniors. Those guys have stuck with us. You had 2 seniors there that could have left early, decided to come back, and we're so happy that they did, and we get a chance to honor them on senior night.
FSU comes out throwing against a very tough run defense. They weren't even going to try to put a square peg in a round hole, so they took him out of the box. Tate gets the touchdown, 7-zip, and this was where FSU reversed the trend and started exploding out to some leads.
Yeah, they started exploding out to some leads, and the defense started playing extremely well, playing fast, playing downhill, and really punishing people.
Defense allowed just 146 total yards in this game. Travis Rudolph, the junior, with a great effort here to get into the end zone from 20 yards out. 28-zip, and then fittingly on senior night, couple of seniors get a chance to shine, Sean McGuire and Freddie Stevenson.
Yeah, and you feel so great for a guy like Sean McGuire, really a team guy, to go out there and get a chance to finish off his career with a touchdown pass.
And Freddie Stevenson, an unsung hero. Unsung is another word for fullback, as he gets in there, and Florida State wins it 45-7. Dalvin, by the way, didn't get the all-time rushing record at home. We had to wait a week. We go to Syracuse. He could have named his rushing total this day against Syracuse, I think. Here's the record breaker.
Yeah, and I mean, he just exploded through the line, and it was that picture all day long. It looked like a track meet. The holes were just huge out there. Offensive line, tight ends, again, did a tremendous job opening up those gaps for him. And, Dalvin does what Dalvin does.
Rudolph with another touchdown catch there. And the defense, Brian Burns, the freshman, 2.5 sacks in this game. Syracuse playing without its starting quarterback, but really overmatched. And now it's just the Dalvin Cook show. Just add to the total. He finishes with 225 yards and 4 touchdowns rushing.
Yeah, I mean, just another spectacular performance by Dalvin. I tell you, we're really going to miss this young man once he's gone. I just enjoyed watching him play, the passion that he plays with, and just a great team guy, which you just don't see that a whole lot from guys that play at his caliber.
That's what I was going to say. He's a selfless guy, a team guy, despite all the individual accolades. And he made Syracuse look silly. Looked a little fast on that turf, too, didn't he?
Yeah, I tell you what.
Big smile, 45-14. The Noles get the win. So we come back home, and this really is going to – are we going to feel okay about the season, or are we going to feel good, all things considered? Well, it's funny how the Florida game has a way of determining that.
Yeah, it's all about Florida. It's a heated, hated rivalry. We went out there, and we played extraordinarily well from the word go, and it was just an exciting time to be a Nole.
FSU's defense leads the country in sacks here. A sack fumble leads to the first score of the game, and Florida's seeing visions of Dalvin Cook in their heads too, because he's run all over them during his career.
Yeah, he has. And again, he showed up big against the Florida schools. Florida State again, the state champions. It's something that you go back and you're able to tell your kids, listen, this is what I did. I own Miami, Florida, and USF.
Despite FSU dominating this game, it was 10-6 in the middle of the third, and this is where it finally broke open. 46-yard touchdown scoring on a third long, and Rudolph gets in, and from there FSU cruised.
Yeah, Jimbo came back to a play that Francois missed a little earlier and hit it down big.
Appleby sacked again by DeMarcus Walker, 15 sacks for that defensive leader, and fittingly, he celebrates with the Gatorhead, something that you did a time or two in your career, Corey. But you beat Miami, that's 4 in a row over Florida, and 6 out of 7 years for Jimbo. Again, the overall record's 9-3, but you're not going to apologize for beating Florida or Miami.
No, absolutely not. You're definitely going to cherish that moment for the rest of your life. 4-0 against Florida is huge. You'll be able to own anything in the state of Florida you want going on. Walk in any restaurant in Tallahassee and get a good meal. It's just, you look at that and you say, man, I beat Florida 4 years in a row.
And they beat Miami 4 years in a row. So this is the first class in history to go 8-0 against their two rivals. So fittingly, the big plays for Corey and I from the second half of the season, well, they came against the rivals. I went with the Miami side of the ledger. We'll get to Corey's next. I had a tie here in this Miami game. If you don't get the pick from McFadden, you probably don't start the comeback. So that begins the comeback. And then here, as Miami goes for the tie, what do you get but the blocked PAT, and Florida State celebrates that 7th straight victory over the Canes. So those were my big plays from the second half of the season. And again, DeMarcus Walker with that big hand getting up there. But Corey, you went to a sequence that really set the tone for that final game of the regular season when the Gators came to Doak Campbell Stadium.
Yeah, when you go back and you look at that Florida game, I went to that opening drive where Florida State stopped the Gators 4 downs inside the 5 and sent them off again with no touchdowns in this game, 3 years running, or 2.5 years running, that the Gators don't see the end zone. So that just really kind of opened the door for what that game began and how it finished.
And it opened the door, along with a Louisville loss to Kentucky, for FSU to get a matchup with Michigan in the Orange Bowl. As we've already talked about, it's going to be a terrific game. We'll turn our attention to the Wolverines when we come back. Stay with us.
Inside the Helmet is presented by Hyundai.
Jacob Pugh, junior, outside linebacker, Dade City, Florida. I moved up here to Tallahassee my freshman year, and I first started off in a little small town called Monticello, right outside of Tallahassee. Toward the end of my sophomore year, I transferred over to Tallahassee and went to Gabby. When I came up here, I started getting opportunities, you know what I'm saying, like to receive scholarship offers, colleges and stuff like that, so it was great. I was a Florida fan, and I don't know how, it just grew on me from being in Tallahassee and being recruited by Florida State, and I started coming to the games, and I just fell in love with it. My mom, she was like a real big factor in my life. She played a big role, and she kind of got me where I am today. She kept me on the right path, kept me in school, and she just always raised me to be a respectful young man. I like to go back to the country, man. I like to go back to the woods and just, I like to hang out. Like, I'm not used to being in the city, you know what I'm saying? Because where I'm from is just a lot of farms, you know what I'm saying? So, like, I like to stay in the house, but when I'm down, I just like to be outside. Actually, I play the drums at the church. I play the drums all my life. Well, actually, my roommate is also talented. He's very talented with the piano. He plays a lot of instruments. Janaris Robinson, number 11. I love being around my teammates. That's where I get my joy, you know what I'm saying, and happiness from being around my teammates. Because, I mean, these are the only people I know. I'm with them 85% of the day, so. Honestly, I just like to joke around, you know what I'm saying? I'm not a serious person. I mean, I can be serious at times, but I'm not a serious person. I like to joke around and have fun. I mean, I always experienced it from sitting in the bleachers, but and seeing, you know what I'm saying, the players run out in the field. My first time actually running out of the tunnel, I was just like, yeah, I'm here now, you know what I'm saying? That's what I've been waiting on. I'm actually playing with the first game of the season against Oklahoma State. I played the third snap of the game, and they called me. I didn't expect for them to call me, but it just kind of hit me. It was just overwhelming. I went out there, I made some mistakes, but welcome to college football.
Ages break out their best dance moves when the camera is on them at Dope Campbell Stadium, but one man takes it to the next level. Meet Mark Bartel. He has become a signature part of video board shows during Florida State football games. He never fails to be pumping up the crowd with his dance moves in Section 37.
It's an honor, it's a pleasure to see myself up there. I mean, you couldn't ask for a better section of fans to be with. I've been with them for over 25 years, and they all have seen my children grow up.
I'll tell you what, having my old man screaming right next to me as loud as he can, there's nothing more that pumps me up.
This family man has been a season ticket holder since 1989. Over the years, his tailgate traditions have evolved.
Start 4 hours before game day. He'd pump out music out of his van and I'd dance on that thing for 4 hours. My children came along and brought them into it.
Out of the last 189 games, Mark has only missed one. His two sons attend FSU and now see their dad from a different perspective.
When I became a student, I started sitting in the student section is when it became nostalgic. Because, like, everyone around would be like, that's the dad, that's the dancing dad. And turn around sometimes and be like, well, that's my dad. And they're like, yeah, okay.
And then after a game, he sat there and told me that, he says, man, every time I came up, the student section just went crazy. And that's an honor. I mean, I really appreciate that.
Just him alone has such a huge impact on the stands and the fans around him. It's pretty cool.
The student section is not the only one that notices Mark's dance moves. Gene Deckerhoff, the voice of the Noles, mentioned him during his radio show.
I don't know what is in his Coke Zero. It's something more than we have at this booth.
And the Bartell boys were together, hearing it for the first time.
I'm looking at the screen right now. Somebody's dad is jamming, man. He is getting it on, baby.
I lost those moves 20 years ago.
That's an honor. I got Gene talking about me now. Good old Gene Deckerhoff. That's sweet.
But what fans cannot see on the video board or hear on the radio is the story of Mark and his two sons.
My dad. Oh, there are a lot of things that can describe my dad. I mean, he's emotional and excitable, as I think everyone in these stands can agree. He's a great teacher and a great person to work with.
The atmosphere at Doak Campbell Stadium holds a special place in Mark's heart.
I try to be calm all through the year, usually before every season. The drive to the stadium, I get emotional. I'm an emotional guy. I try to hold that back, and then I come in and we get a little fired up, not too much. But when the marching chiefs, when that gate opens up, it's gone. I mean, that's the emotion.
Mark's passion for Florida State inspires his sons to carry on the legacy.
Growing up, it feels like it means a lot more to me now. Because when you're younger, that's kind of all I knew. And like now, it's just really, really cool to look back and see, like, we built a legacy. And how the football team and the school just means so much to our family.
I mean, anything I can do to help, you know, get the fans excited and pumped up into the game, you know, that's what it's all about. I mean, it's without the fan base, it's just a football game. And there is nothing like our stadium and our fans. It really isn't.
For now, the Bartell boys will be in Section 37 with all eyes on them. They will turn the page to the next set of traditions.
We're gonna have to carry the baton.
We have a lot to live up to, but I think we got
a lot of practicing to do with our dancing. At least I know I do, so.
Hey, I'm still learning.
I'm Savannah Slifer for the Jimbo Fisher Show.
The Look Ahead is presented by Florida Farm Bureau Insurance.
Welcome back. Let's talk about this Michigan-Florida State matchup, Corey. First, relatively brief history, but boy, some great memories for FSU fans, particularly the second ever meeting. Michigan led the series 1-0. FSU goes back to Ann Arbor in 1991, and this is like the second play from scrimmage. T-Buck to the house.
Robbing one from Desmond Howard. I mean, what a matchup when you look back at the history of Florida State and Michigan and those two players and how dynamic they were.
Howard had a couple of touchdowns this day. Buckley had a couple of interceptions. Florida State would score 51 points. And Bobby Bowden, the Riverboat Gambler, mixed in a little bit just for the Wolverine fans to remember. A fake field goal here leads to a touchdown by William Floyd.
Yeah, the young man always kept one in his pocket.
51-31, that's the most points ever allowed at the Big House. And that was the last time that these teams met. So all the way back in 1991. So the series is even at one game apiece. And so you fast forward to a completely different generation. Obviously, new coaches in the mix with Jimbo and Harbaugh. And this is a Michigan team that, you know, you think Michigan, you think defense in terms of what they've done this year.
Yeah, and you really look at their defense and their two players that kind of jump off the map for you. But overall, you look at what Don Brown has done as a defensive coordinator, coming over from Boston College, has done exceptionally well with these young men to get them prepared every week. I think number two scoring defense in the country. They just go out there and they put pressure on you and force you into mistakes.
This is Jabril Peppers, who, as you know, was a Heisman finalist because he was so versatile, returns kicks and punts. But what you see when you're watching the defensive tape is that he's really, really physical.
Yeah, very physical. And he's just a kind of spinoff of Don Brown and his system, a physical system. They rotate eight guys up front on that defensive line. They really get after it. They're fast to the ball, and they're going to hit you.
Peppers also played some running back. He caught some passes. I think he played 15 different positions. But again, physicality sticks out for him, and you can believe FSU will see a lot of him when they're watching their tape and their pre-bowl prep.
Yeah, and when you watch him, he does just a great job getting downhill, hitting you. There's a lot of Derwin James and Jabril Peppers.
You mentioned that name, and we don't know for sure, but it appears that Derwin James won't play for FSU in this bowl game. Let's continue the conversation, though, about Michigan. Jordan Lewis, another part of this defense that In some of the all Big Ten balloting, all 11 starters received some accolades, first team, second team, third team, all Big Ten. That's how much talent is out here, and he's part of the mix as a cover corner.
Yeah, and he's their best corner. He's really a shutdown guy for them. He's done an exceptional job of going out there, forcing the ball to go the other way because he's just, as you'll see through these highlights, he's just got tight coverage every time you turn around and watch this young man.
Had just a couple of interceptions, but did have 10 passes broken up, and he too will be a marked player as Jimbo starts to game plan against a familiar foe. You mentioned Don Brown when he was at Boston College. BC did an admirable job of keeping Florida State's offense at bay a little bit, so that's why some may be leaning towards Michigan in this, but I think Jimbo will be up to the challenge.
Yeah, Jimbo will definitely be up to the challenge. A lot of those coaches that are on that Michigan staff, Jimbo's familiar with, and so it won't be a mystery when we walk out on that field on December 30th.
One thing we know, we'll have a healthy DeAndre Francois. He was worn down as the season went on because of taking these kind of hits. So a month to refresh, and I say that because the fact that he can run with the ball is going to be key in this matchup.
Yeah, I don't think we saw DeAndre Francois healthy from the word go of this season. So to give him a month off, I'm just anxious to see this young man and the growth that he has over this season, and now to have a little health behind that growth could be dangerous.
Threw for 3,128 yards as a redshirt freshman, 18 touchdowns passing, 6 picks, protected the ball well, and again, a dual threat guy. Looks like he's got a very high ceiling for FSU.
Yeah, and a freshman. How about that?
Yeah, and you know, this is one of the rare times this season where we saw raw emotion from him, not just on that touchdown, but after the game too. It was almost like there was some relief because he's so, not that he was putting pressure on himself, but he's so businesslike, tunnel vision. It was good to see that. Of course, quarterback like DeAndre always appreciates if you have a running back like Dalvin, which he did have. And I don't know, pull out your thesaurus, Corey, and see if we can dig deeper to describe what he did.
I think the thesaurus is just, you know, we've tapped out there. The superlatives there are just, you know, we can't say much more about him. Guy was cheating, in my opinion, on that vote that happened in New York. And the dope walker for that opinion, from my opinion. Just a talented running back. The NFL is going to get a great one. A guy that, again, is a team guy, is going to be a great locker room guy. He's a glue of this team. We really enjoyed watching Dalvin Cook.
1,620 rushing yards, 18 touchdowns, and still, even though we've seen him, he's got a blend that I think surprises defenses when they see him, and the blend is speed with some power. This guy's 210. He's not 185 like Warrick Dunn was. He's got a good mix.
Yeah, and it just when you watch him get the ball, his patience is something that you don't see very often watching the game. But when he gets the ball, he just doesn't look like he's running that fast until he eats up whatever angle you thought you had.
Yeah, exactly right. All right, so DeAndre and Dalvin offensively, DeMarcus on defense. DeMarcus Walker was the vocal leader of this defense, and on a national stage Labor Day night, he introduced himself to the college football world with 4.5 sacks against Ole Miss.
Yeah, DeMarcus Walker, he won't go down as the fastest defensive lineman or the biggest defensive lineman to play at Florida State, but he plays with so much heart and determination, and that's what's made this young man great. That's why he's thrived in this FSU program, is because he works his butt off. Every play he works hard. He doesn't take plays off. You couldn't ask for much more from a defensive player.
64 tackles on the year, 15 sacks, part of a defense that, for as maligned as it was, led the country in sacks this year and wound up, when you adjust it, a top 20 defense this year.
Yeah, it was just great to see, and it was led by him. But it was great to see these guys get together and say, listen, we're not playing Florida State defense. Came together, signed the contract that Jimbo put in front of them, and then took on the task of going out there and getting better.
One note about Michigan's offense, you know, Florida State struggled against the dual threat quarterbacks, and that's not what Michigan is with Wilton Spite, who was injured a little bit at the end of the year, and I'm sure he'll be fine for the bowl game, but he's more of a stationary guy back there.
Yeah, he's a stationary guy, and they don't ask him to do too much. Averaged about 212 yards a game passing the ball, but he tries to cut down on his turnovers. When he does turn the ball over, it hurts this team tremendously. They're big turnovers, but when he's able to go out there and just manage the game, Michigan's a foe to be dealt with.
December 30th at the Orange Bowl. Friday night, it'll be the only game in town. That's the day before the college football playoffs. It's a great way to kick off that weekend. Should be a terrific matchup. We'll have some final thoughts on Michigan and FSU right after this. Some closing thoughts now. First of all, you look at Florida State's alumni base, and it's biggest in South Florida, so great to be in the Orange Bowl there. As we're sitting here, Dalvin Cook hasn't made his announcement, but we presume he's turning pro, and he's back in Miami where he grew up. So there's a lot of nostalgic points that go with this one, too.
Yeah, and a lot of these guys are from the Miami area, so they get a chance to go home, spend some time with their families, but also get to play their games in front of that family. So it's going to be a huge, huge game. This isn't one of those games that Florida State's going to have to push themselves to get up for. It's a great opponent in Michigan.
Michigan in the early lines, about a touchdown favorite or so. Michigan finished 10-2. It was widely thought that they were a college football playoff team, and then they lost two of their final three. So what do you see as the keys in this game for FSU?
Yeah, when I look at this game and I look at the keys to this game, you look at Michigan, you look at Harbaugh, we've got to control the line of scrimmage. They're gonna line up and they're gonna try and push us around and get off that ball and shove us around up front. So we've got to control the line of scrimmage. And then secondly, we've got to win the turnover battle. Michigan has done a great job of forcing turnovers during the course of the season. We've got to go out there and we've got to win the turnover battle and possibly turn some of those turnovers into points. We've got to do that to win this game.
It is going to be a fun way to ring out 2016 and ring in 2017. Thanks so much for joining us. He's Corey, I'm Tom. Happy holidays, happy new year, and we'll see you next year right here. So long, everybody.
This has been the Jimbo Fisher Show, brought to you by the Florida Lottery, over $30 billion and counting to education. Just imagine. The energy-saving conservation programs of TECO People's Gas. Coca-Cola, try a game changer of your own. Taste the feeling. SunTrust, the official bank of Florida State Athletics. And by Nick's Toggery, provider of Coach Fisher's wardrobe.